Very brief comments, Anderson, but as I was saying earlier, this is just the president really kind of setting the stage, giving the broad highlights in terms of what happened tonight. We do expect to hear more from other senior administration officials throughout the night to get those details. But Anderson, this is not a situation where the cameras go into the White House and everything's able to come out live and to all of our viewers out there instantaneously. And so that is why you're seeing the president make these comments to reporters, a pool of reporters there at Mar-a-Lago. That video is now en route to some kind of feeding operation where you're going to see these comments shortly. But the president, just the last few moments, making reference to beautiful babies cruelly murdered in a barbaric attack by the Syrian government. And so, as I was saying earlier, talking to a senior administration official, you do get the sense from these comments tonight, Anderson, that he was deeply affected by these images that the whole world was shocked by earlier this week.
Right.
Anderson.
So these comments have just been given by the President of the United States, as Jim just said, to a pool of reporters. As soon as we get the tape of that, it's not broadcast live. It's not going to be the live address to the American people. We will obviously play that. We'll tape turn it. We'll play that for you soon. Second we get it. David Axelrod, as you were watching all of this, I mean, with your experience in the White House and the Obama administration, obviously an Obama administration which, you know, talked about a red line, which considered military action, which went to Congress. What do you make of tonight?
Well, obviously, this sends, if the intent was to send a message to Syria, there's also a message to the rest of the world attached, which is that President Trump is willing to order this action. There'll be a whole host of secondary questions as to under what authorization he did it, what was the impact of it really, what are the secondary impacts on us, as was mentioned in the discussion earlier. But certainly there is the impression of swift action here, and I think that's part of what he wanted to communicate. But what's so interesting about the statement that Jim Acosta just described is that he reacted so differently in 2013 to an attack that was just as heinous except much larger, and his advice was don't go in. And it's interesting to see the transformation of someone who is now the President of the United States and having to make these decisions from a different perspective, because this is a vastly different approach than the one that he once and not so long ago recommended in response to Syria.
Yeah, even during the campaign, he said, you know, let Russia deal with Syria, let Russia deal with ISIS, let Bashar al-Assad fight ISIS. He seemed very content to not have the U.S. be involved, clearly didn't want to have the U.S. be involved, and as you said, tweeted that repeatedly. But as president, obviously, this has been a huge change for this president just in the last 24, 48 hours or more. Jeff Zeleny is standing by outside Mar-a-Lago where the president is tonight along with his team. Jeff, what are you hearing?
Anderson, I'm being told by a U.S. official that the Trump administration and the president himself informed what I'm told is a broad list of nations and garnered their support for this. One nation not on this list was Russia and Vladimir Putin. That was a question we asked the president earlier this afternoon. Have you spoken with Mr. Putin about this? And he said, I have not yet. I may in the future. But I am told by a U.S. official that the United States did not indeed give a heads up, if you will, to Russia. Of course, so many Russian forces on the ground in Syria there. But I am being told by a U.S. official that the administration did get the support and implicit agreement, if you will, from what we're being told is a broad list of nations. We will find out more specifics on that shortly. As my colleague Jim Acosta was just saying, they are setting up here near Mar-a-Lago for a briefing of some sort, perhaps with the new National Security Advisor, General H.R. McMaster, and other officials. And we will be seeing the president's own words shortly here, Anderson. But this was just not the president's decision alone tonight. They did inform other countries, Anderson.
Jeff, in a moment, I'm going to go back to Colonel Rick Francona, who's actually been at the base that was hit, because I just want to get some more details about what the base is like, given that it's rare to have somebody who is actually there. But Jeff, just in terms of who the president has around him at this point, you talked about the National Security Advisor, General McMaster. General Mattis is there as well. Do you know who else?
Well, certainly. I mean, he is surrounded by most of his, top national security team, the Secretary of State, of course, the Defense Secretary, his new National Security Advisor, you know, other members of the Cabinet as well, from the Treasury Secretary onward. Of course, he is in Mar-a-Lago not for just any old weekend. He is here to have his first face-to-face meeting with the Chinese President. So this, of course, also has ramifications for that visit. But we also saw earlier this evening the Vice President going back into the White House, so we got a sense there that he may be also getting some information here on that. But the president is surrounded, Anderson, by most of his top advisors. Ryan Priebus, the president's chief of staff, Steve Bannon, the chief strategist, who was just removed from the National Security Council. They are here in Florida, as is Jared Kushner, of course, the son-in-law and top advisor, Ivanka Trump, the daughter and a senior advisor as well, all here. So, Anderson, most of the president's staff is actually here in Florida. He calls it the Southern White House, and tonight it certainly is a White House that's quite busy, Anderson.
Yeah, I want to go back to our military panel. Admiral Kirby is joining us. Admiral, as a former State Department spokesman, you've got experience of coordinating with other world leaders. How does that play out? How does that work?
Well, normally that's something like that is done. You know, obviously you're doing this in a hurry, so it's usually done over the phone. And you pick those countries that are most invested in this, that have a stake. I would suspect some of our Gulf allies were consulted, as well as key partners in Europe. I'm not surprised that there wasn't deliberate outreach to the Russian government, at least in Moscow anyway, to give them any kind of a heads up about this, because you don't know what they were going to obviously do with that kind of information. But you do want to try to clear the decks, if you will, diplomatically, as best you can before you do something this major and this significant that is going to have, as Mr. Axelrod said so well, it's going to have ramifications starting very, very soon. I'm frankly a little surprised that we haven't seen a reaction from Moscow yet. That's the thing I'm looking for the most right now. I think they'll probably be the very, very early out of the gates.
Any moment we expect to have you tape of the president who spoke to reporters just a few moments ago that has not yet been broadcast. We're going to give that to you as soon as we get it. 50 to 60 Tomahawk cruise missiles fired from two vessels in the eastern Mediterranean Sea, fired at a particular base believed to be the airbase where the attack, the gas attack in Idlib, was actually launched from. Colonel Rick Francona has actually been to that base in years past when he was the Air Force attaché in the region. Colonel, if you could just talk about what the airbase is like. You said it's actually a relatively small base.
Yeah, it's a small base. I'd call it a bare bones utilitarian base. There's not much air other than the runways. There's an admin area, maintenance area, fueling area. You know, two squadrons. Each squadron would be on a separate side of the base.
About how many aircraft?
They would have a series of. Their squadrons are smaller than ours. Usually 12 to 15. And they would have enough hardened aircraft shelters to house the entire squadron. Now, whether the aircraft were still on the base, we don't know. Whether they were all in the hardened aircraft shelters or were they in some maintenance facility, we don't know that. I hope we'll find out later on. But the base sits out in kind of a farming area. There's not much around it. There's a couple of towns, very, very small towns. So I don't think we're risking a lot of collateral damage here. If all the missiles actually hit on the base, I don't think we're going to be dealing with a large number of civilian casualties. There are military housing areas, but they are off the base, as I recall. I think this was a good target to hit, and I do like the visibility of it because it was easily seen by a lot of the population.
Easily seen from people in Damascus, where the bulk of the population is.
Not as far as Damascus, but they're on the main, Sherat's on that main Damascus Homs Road. You can see it probably from Homs. That much ordnance going off, you can see that from Homs, and I'm sure that was all over the telephone networks and all social media. And of course, we're going to see a lot of government reaction, and I suspect, although there may not have been a lot of civilian casualties, we may see a lot of civilian casualties in the morning, engineered.
Colonel Francona, we understand we're going to be bringing the president's statement in about 2 minutes.